Hello students, today let us revise what we have learned about surfacing the novel by Atwood. When we look at the title of this novel, it is Surfacing, but it is not about surface, it is about depth. In this novel, the protagonist goes in search of her missing father, and she also in that process delves deep into a lake. So it is about depth. She wants to look into herself, to search for her own identity. The central theme of this novel is about the place of women in the urban patriarchal society. She also throws light on the double standards, or how women are treated unequally and how injustice is being done to women. In the novel, she says that women are expected to be better than men morally, and even the feminists themselves think that a woman should always be morally right, and if she is not an angel and if she happens to have human feelings as most of us have, then or else if she displays any kind of strength or power, creative or otherwise, then the woman is not considered to be a human. Instead, she is considered to be a witch or a Medusa, a destructive, powerful, scary monster. So when a woman talks about feelings, or when she talks about having equal status, when she talks about freedom, she is considered to be a different being, not at all a human being. She is considered to be a witch. In the novel, we read such kind of feminist issues being raised. So this novel is about the equality and freedom of women. Modern woman's life is characterized by struggle for survival and assertion of individual dignity. The works of many women writers are concerned about their own problems. Their works center around such crucial issues as how women see themselves and how they condition and direct their lives and thoughts. Even the novels of Margaret Atwood deal with these issues. So in one of the interviews, Margaret Atwood said, "I am defining my feminism as human equality and freedom of choice." The novel Surfacing is also about distances and differences between human beings. The Canadians and Americans have different opinion about this novel. Canadians consider this novel to be a novel on nationalism, whereas Americans consider it to be a masterpiece of feminism. Many critics have considered it as a novel about identity on a national level and on the female, a personal level. So it is both a feminist and a nationalistic novel. In the beginning of this novel, we are introduced to a nameless protagonist who is an orphan. We find her searching for her missing father. She also withdraws herself into the past from a male-dominated capitalistic society. She remains nameless throughout the novel. She is traveling to her childhood cottage to find her missing father, and in the process she descends into the lake and then ascends from it. Her transformation through knowledge and her decision to return to the city. So here the protagonist has two problems. One is that her father is missing. The second is that she herself has lost her identity. She is troubled by self-deception and also self-doubt. She has an inability to express or speak to others. She wants to overcome all these problems. Therefore, the novel is the attempt or the effort of the protagonist to establish peace with past and present. There is search for identity to overcome desperate self-deceptive life. In the novel, we find the protagonist to be unreliable. She gives one information at one point in the novel and later contradicts herself. We note the novelist giving details about her marriage and then having a baby. But later we come to know that she is not married and doesn't even have a kid. So she is leading a life of self-deception. Being an artist, the protagonist gives several visual images throughout the novel. Let us try to note a few of them. She is traveling to her native place with her three friends, Joe, Anna and David. On the way, they happen to see urbanization or destruction of natural plants and natural ecological systems. She talks about it, calls it as a disease spreading from the south. South means America. So America has brought in all the changes, all the modern modern advanced changes have taken place. The road, the old road is closed and new one is being constructed. In the process, several trees have been cut. So there is this image of the disease spreading from south. The other image given here is that of the bottle house, which the party, that is narrator and her friends, happen to see on the way. The friends find it very curious and interesting. They want to take pictures of it for the movie that they are making, which is titled Random Samples. Whereas for the narrator, it is a symbolic gateway to her past. And on a service station, in a service station where they go to fill in gas, they also notice a moose family with the father moose, mother moose and a baby or boy moose. And later they find another moose at a distance. So this is daughter moose. And the protagonist thinks that it is a symbol for herself. The description of a stuffed moose is an obvious image of her family status. The daughter, separated from her own family, as well as the plunge to Kaman. And as they travel further, they come across her native place, and she says it is her home ground, foreign territory. That is, she is unable to recognize or feel at home in her own place because it has changed so much. So she says that she has come here to recover or reclaim whatever she has lost in her life. This is what we get in the novel. I feel deprived of something, as though I cannot really get here unless I have suffered, as though the first view of the lake, which we can see now, blue and cool as a redemption. So in the novel, as the protagonist is troubled, she is having several psychological problems such as self-doubt, self-delusion, inability of expression. She wants to overcome those by learning about her past and what mistakes she must have done in the past. She wants to reconcile with the past so that she can live a better life. She goes to her father's friend's house. His name is Paul. She speaks to Paul about her father. He is not able to give much information. Paul asks the narrator about narrator's husband, and at that point in the novel we read this. The narrator replies to Paul, "Yes, he is here." She means that her husband is traveling with her. I say, skipping over the lie, even in my own mind, what he means is that a man should be handling this. Joe will do as a stand-in. So once again, she is cheating herself by telling Paul that Joe is her husband, because a woman cannot travel on her own. That is what people of the village think. She needs somebody to help her, to assist her. Continuing to read from the novel, my status is a problem. That is, protagonist is unmarried. She cannot tell anybody about her marital status. And even Paul thinks that she is married and has come with her husband. But the narrator can somehow manage, because she is wearing her old wedding ring, that is the wedding ring from the previous marriage. And this ring has helped her to get a rented house, so to have marital status gives recognition in the society. She is reminded of her parents, and she feels that her parents wouldn't forgive her for her sudden marriage and hasty divorce. And now she has come with her husband, and the child is not with her. So Paul's wife, Madam, might ask her about the child, and she has a ready answer that the child is in the city. And the narrator tells us that her parents wouldn't forgive her if if they know that if they come to know that she has left her child in the city, and when she comes home to her cottage, she finds the old chicken fire fence which her father had kept, and he had not removed it because he thought that one day his grandchildren would come to play there. This also the narrator considers it to be a failure, her failure. And while they were traveling, or even earlier, Anna had told the narrator that she had a good childhood, that the narrator had a good childhood. Narrator tells us that it was indeed true. She and her brother had a good childhood. Though it was the time of war, her parents did not allow them to know the difficulties of war. They had kept them away from reality. Though she was brought up at the time of war, though she never had experience of suffering that is a result of war, the children were not allowed to have experience of that kind. Therefore, when she grows up later in her life also, she prefers to live in false memories. I have tried to explain what a self-deception is. So the narrator has been living her life in a deceptive manner. That is, she has created her own story, which is full of lies. So she has hidden the truth about her even from herself. The memories of her marriage, the abortion, the divorce haunt her throughout and have altered her perception of life. The divorce comes as a consequence of the abortion that she made to undergo by her so-called husband. As I mentioned earlier, the entire story told by the narrator, it keeps changing. The narrator herself is unreliable. In the beginning, we are introduced to this person as her husband, but later we come to know that they are not married. There is also the description of the abortion that she had and how guilty she feels about the entire process. Let me read from the novel. "He said I should do it. He made me do it. He talked about it as though it was legal, simple, like getting a wart removed. He said it wasn't a person, only an animal. I should have seen that was no different. It was hiding in me as if in a burrow, and instead of granting it sanctuary, I let them catch it." The four characters depicted by Atwood in the novel are not in harmony with each other. They are all unwilling to share their personal history or emotional experiences with each other. The protagonist tells us that Anna is her best friend, "my best woman friend. I have known her for 2 months." Though Anna is her best friend, there are many things that they don't know about each other. So it is there through their friendship that Atwood exposes the falsity of modern friendship. It is a parody of true friendship, and also the relationship between narrator and Joe, that is also satirized. It is presented as a mechanical and casual relationship. To read from the novel, I am in the back seat with the pack sacks. This one, Joe, is sitting beside me, chewing gum and holding my hand. They both pass the time. So all the relationships don't have any depth in them. Regarding Anna and David, we come to know that they have been married for the past 9 years. In the beginning, they appear as perfect couple. Even the protagonist wants to know the magic behind the success of their marriage. Protagonist asks Anna about the secret, and Anna tells her that the couple should make an emotional commitment to each other, and it is very unpredictable, so they should be ready to face whatever comes across. And the narrator thinks that her marriage was not like this. It was not like skying. It was more like jumping off a cliff. That was the feeling she had when she was married. And the jump would result in a smash. So she has a different experience of marriage. Whereas as time passes by, the narrator understands that Anna and David are not perfect couple. They assume and act as a perfect couple before the outer world, and inwardly they hate each other and are untruthful to each other. Fear dominates them. And through their characters, the author, Margaret Atwood, tells us that their story is like that of a fairy tale. And we find Anna putting on lots of makeup. Anna tells the protagonist that she believed herself to be a princess who ended up living in a castle. And Anna is extremely cautious and conscious in putting her makeup. The protagonist tells her that in the village, in the island, there was no need of putting makeup because nobody will look at her. Anna answers her that David doesn't like her without makeup. And then David doesn't even know that she wears makeup. This shows the falsity of their marriage. Anna is a victim of her own socially inculcated narcissism. She accepts the stereotyped female identity. By the end of the novel, Anna has learned nothing from her return to the natural world. In the novel, Anna is presented as a victim of patriarchal society. Though she goes back to nature, she gains nothing out of it. David and Anna represent the dangerous and artificial modern world with its mechanical and divided sensibility. Whereas Joe, he is not so mechanical. For For the protagonist, he appears to be a human animal still capable of love. In the first few pages, we have a description about Joe. This is what we read there. He is like the buffalo on the US nickel, shaggy and blunt snouted, with small clenched eyes and the defiant but insane look of a species once dominant but threatened with extinction. The protagonist lives with Joe because he does not make her sad, and also he does not talk much, which she thinks is an asset. She also agrees that nothing has made her sadder since her divorce with her previous husband. This means that she has lost her ability to feel anything after her divorce. So with this, we will complete part one. Let us continue our discussion in part two.